The health of any city depends on getting clean water in and getting waste out. Both of these challenges involve a combination of infrastructure and incentives. Left to their own devices, individual households are often willing to drink dangerous water that puts the whole city at risk. They are even more willing to dump their waste in places where it can spread disease or at least a foul stench. The economic phrase for this problem is externality, which refers to any setting where the action of one person impacts someone else in a way that is not mediated by a market mechanism. Cities are full of externalities, some good, some bad. The pleasure that I get from walking by a charming building or a display window is a positive externality. The risk that my waste may infect my neighbor is a negative externality. 2,600 years ago, the Etruscan rulers of Rome built the Cloaca Maxima, which literally means greatest sewer, to carry the filth of that city to the river Tiber. The Romans prized their sewerage system so much that they thought a goddess, Cloacina, watched over it. It seems like these sewers were originally open-air ditches that were eventually covered over. The so-called cut-and-cover method is still often the cheapest way of generating a tunnel. For sewers, the cover makes a big difference because it eliminates the stench. The construction of the great sewer reflected the political competence of the Tarquin kings, who were able to press poorer Romans into service, digging the great ditches. The Romans are justly famous for their engineering feats, and aqueducts are particularly famous examples. But it seems that the original engineers of Rome's sewer system were Etruscan. The Romans, however, were exceptionally sanitary. Throughout most of urban history, waste was either just dumped into city streets or left in the ground in pit latrines or outhouses. The more sophisticated, modern version of this method is called a septic system, which can work pretty well at the low density levels seen in American suburbs. Septic tanks become distinctly unsanitary when they exist in the midst of great cities such as Manila, a metropolitan region with more than 10 million people that relies primarily on septic tanks. In the case of water and sewers and plenty of other urban services, there is something of a tale of two technologies. One technology is individual and cheap. The other is collective and expensive. In transportation, auto rickshaws and jitneys are an example of cheap technologies. Trains and bus rapid transit are the collective, expensive technology. In water, the cheap individual technology is a shallow well. The expensive technology is water piped from some clean, distant source. In sewers, pit latrines and open street defecation are the cheapest technologies. Sewers are the expensive alternative. Sometimes water and sewers are dealt with simultaneously because they both involve pipes. Baron Haussmann built a combined water and sewage system for Paris in the mid-19th century, but just as typically, as cities get richer, they get clean water before they deal with their sewers. Switching from the cheap technology to the expensive one usually requires a combination of both public will and a private willingness to pay, unless the public sector is strong enough to either force or subsidize everyone to adopt. The private willingness to pay for water is greater than the willingness to pay for sewers because more of the benefits of clean water are reaped by the individual household. With sewerage, many of the costs of not switching to the sanitary option are borne by others. So, for example, Boston began building its municipal water system in the 1840s. The city didn't seriously tackle sewerage until the 1870s. One might think that good enough water eliminates the need for good sewerage. If you're getting your water from far away, then maybe it's okay that filth is piling up nearby. The economists Marcy Olson and Claudia Golden have shown that this logic is false, and that water and sewerage are complements, not substitutes. They looked at water and sewerage reforms in Greater Boston in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The biggest reductions in infant mortality occurred when both water and sewerage were improved together. Jointly, they estimate that these improvements can account for 37% of the decline in infant mortality over a 36-year period. Water and sewerage seem to be complements because of the nature of disease. You can get sick from water or sick from filthy, faulty sewers. To protect the lives of babies, you need to eliminate both sources of infection. Since poorer people aren't always willing to pay for sewers, governments face a choice. Either they can just accept a status quo of pit latrines, or they can subsidize sewers, or they can punish poorer people who don't pay for sewerage. Yet subsidized sewer services open the sluice gates to public waste. Fining poorer people for failing to pay for sewers raises the specter of abuse and injustice. There are, as usual, no free lunches. A related question is whether to provide water and sewers directly as a municipal service, or perhaps through an independent public entity with some autonomy from elected leaders, or whether to turn to private providers. Again, no answer is perfect. Private providers have a tendency to underprovide services to poorer people and to bribe public officials. Municipal services are often inefficient and become machines for producing patronage jobs rather than a sanitary city. Independent public authorities can avoid the worst parts of politics, but since they are less accountable to voters, they can end up doing almost nothing. The UN and the World Bank often measure urban sanitation by assessing the share of households that are connected to the sewer system or have access to improved water. Yet often, those services are intermittent at best. My work in Zambia, which is joint with Nava Ashraf, Abe Holland, and Bryce Steinberg, finds that poor residents complain of water outages all the time. And when the water goes out, children get sick, not just from waterborne illnesses, but also from other contagious diseases, perhaps because they stop washing their hands. Economic activity goes down, and girls spend more time doing chores like carrying water and less time doing schoolwork. We also find that outages are more common when households pay by the month instead of by the cubic meter. Since water companies have less incentive to ensure the flow of water when households pay a fixed monthly fee, they may invest less in those households. They certainly seem to take longer to resolve water complaints in areas where the households pay a fixed fee. Once again, incentives matter as much as infrastructure. If we are going to make the slums of the developing world livable, and that is one of the great callings of the 21st century, we're going to need to spend a lot of time thinking about sewers and about the institutional backdrop behind those sewers.